It's attorney Brooke Goff. I'm doing my video this week on workers' comp because I get so many questions on a weekly basis, and I think these things are so important. I got to tell you, so many people will contact me and say, "I wish I knew you when," right? Because if had I, my result would have been different. You know, that's why I do these. I don't do these to get business, although I do get much business from them in full disclosure, because many people realize that I know what I'm talking about and I'm very good at it. And why wouldn't you want to have an attorney that you know, that's like that? I don't know why you wouldn't. So firstly, we're doing this was supposed to be the five myths of workers' comp. So then I'm writing, okay, what five myths? There's a lot more than five. Can I share with them? And then I just kept writing, and then I got to eight. So we're going to do the eight myths of workers' compensation cases for Connecticut. And I don't care who you are, if you've had a comp case, if you know somebody, anybody that lives in Connecticut should see this video. Because if you haven't been injured at work, there's a chance you will be injured at work. And if you're not injured at work, you might have a family member, you might have a friend that's injured at work, and this video can save them a lot of time, aggravation, and help them make better choices from the onset. All right, myth number one. Reporting the incident to your employer is the same as opening a comp case. Now, I'm not going to make the noise because it's a bit embarrassing, but you know that, like, the ding, like when it's wrong? So we're going to pretend that after I say these, that ding goes off, the little bell, because it's wrong. The answer is no, big myth. So let me explain to you, and I'm going to show you some things and get fun with some of the forms here. But firstly, reporting the incident to your employer is not the same as opening a comp case. You're reporting the incident to your employer, which you need to do. But if you look at the statutes, it's to report a, to open a comp case, you have to do what's called a 30C. It's got to be sent certified to both workers' compensation, where your case is going to be pending, and the employer. If you do not do one of these, you have not opened your case. Now, some employers here and there do something called the first report of injury form. That will at least get your claim reported to the commission, okay? But I got to tell you, how many people, and I mean my clients all watch these, I don't expect any of you to speak up, or, you know, I'm not going to say names, but how many of these people got to me and they're like, "I told my employer I have a claim number." No, that claim number is your employer's in workers' comp insurance claim number. That's not a claim number for comp. And the problem is it's workers' compensation number. If you don't have a workers' comp number, that means it hasn't been open with comp. So good luck requesting a hearing. You're going to say, "I need a hearing." They're going to say, "Who the hell are you?" So it's not the way it works, okay? You have to open a case with the commission, and your employer will have, obviously will notify their insurance. You will have two numbers. You will have a workers' compensation claim number through workers' comp in Connecticut. Then you will have a claim number from the workers' compensation insurance, okay? Two very different things, not the same numbers, different. And honestly, by only telling your employer and having your employer contact their insurance, you don't have even rights at that point to ask for a hearing because you have no claim open with the commission, okay? So just because you report the incident to your employer, it's not the same as opening a comp case. To open a comp case, you have to file 30C. It's got to be sent certified. Guys, do not throw it first class mail. It's as if it didn't happen. Save your 50 cents now to send a letter. It's got to be certified. $7 or whatever it costs to the employer and to workers' comp. This is the 30C form, and it's backwards. I know, can't fix it, but just that's a 30C form. Now, if you're considering getting an attorney, you should have your attorney do this because this is actually a legal document, right? And you want to make sure it's filled out properly. So if you're considering getting an attorney, you have a year to file this form. So don't like stress out or anything. But your attorney will file this form if you get an attorney that knows what they're doing. Now, again, there's a year to file it. When these cases come in, we file them right away. Why? Because you have to, all right? Because you want to make sure, I mean, when that 1 year point comes around, if this isn't filed, you have a risk of the insurance company for your employer saying, "Hey, we're going to deny this claim. It wasn't properly opened." Now, if they've paid you wages and they pay for your medicals, they're going to have a hard time winning the argument. But let's just say you've been treating on your own, kind of doing your own thing. And now, like, you know, you see one of my videos and you're like, "You know what? I really feel like, you know, I've been using my own health insurance." Don't do that. And I really feel like I should talk to an attorney. If you come in my office, we'll say a year and a month later and say, "Hey, Brooke, look, like, I've been using my insurance. You bring a stack of medical records this high. You never reported it to workers' comp, and you never submitted any medicals to your employer, and they never paid in your wages." You might lose, and you're forever barred, okay? So this is serious stuff. 1 year from the date of injury, this needs to be filed. If you're getting an attorney, let your attorney file this, okay, for you? But again, going back to the myth, reporting the incident to your employer is the same as opening a comp case? The answer is no, that is wrong. two different things. Reporting the incident to your employer, they're going to report it to their insurance, you're going to get a claim number. Then you report it to workers' comp by sending a certified 30C to the employer into the comp, into the employer into workers' comp, whatever jurisdiction you're going to be in. Okay? Myth number one, solved. Myth number two, you do not get to choose your own doctor. Again, if I had sound effects, I would do the hand sign in the back, but we're not going to do that. The answer is no, that's not true. You do get to choose your own doctor. Now, there's some employers, Yale being one, a lot of the healthcare facilities, Harvard Healthcare, this kind of a thing, they have networks of physicians you can choose from, okay? But you don't have to, if they send you to Concentra, you don't have to go there. You go there once, okay, fine. You don't have to continue going there. What they make you think is that you have to continue going to the doctor, they're not going to pay you. The problem is, if you continue to go to their doctor, let's say you see this video and you've gone to Concentra six times, I'm going to have a really hard time getting you to now be able to choose your physician, because there becomes a point, it's commissioner discretion, which is where it becomes dangerous, where the where if you've gone to the doctor enough times at Concentra, they take it as if you've selected them as your doctor and you've agreed that, yes, you want them to treat you. Bad people, bad, okay? You want to see board certified physicians that are not working for the insurance companies or work for the employers, okay? You don't want to see an OCHEL. I mean, look, there's nothing wrong with OCHealth, Concentra, whatever. They'll see you on an emergency basis. It's no different than when you go to a hospital if you get in an accident. But you want to see an ortho. You want to see very good board certified physicians that perform surgeries and everything else. Because Concentra, these doctors usually, if you have a serious problem, refer you out. Their job is to get you back to work as soon as possible, okay? Why are you going to go there? More than once, all right? So you do not get to choose your own doctor is wrong. Yes, in workers' comp, you do get to choose your own doctor. And this is why it's so important early to choose the doctor you want to go to. If the insurance company wants to claim, hey, look, you got to go to our doctor, say, and it's not, you know, one of these like Yale's or Harvard Healthcare that has a list of workers' comp physicians that they approve. If it's just a regular employer and they say, no, you have to go to ours, no way, request an emergency hearing on medical treatment. Got it? Okay. So you do get to choose your own physician under workers' comp. Some employers have lists that you can choose from, but there's multiple doctors on each list. Chiropractors, neuros, orthos, podiatrists, you name it, they're on there, okay? Myth number three, you can sue your employer for negligence due to a comp injury. Let me give you an example for this one. The answer number one is no, you can't. Let me give you an example on this one. So Jane Smith is in, she's at her job, she's a waitress. She slips and falls on water on the floor. Right? And that water shouldn't have been there. The ceiling's leaking, okay? That's what causes the water to be here. And she slips and falls, and she breaks her arm. Serious injury, right? She's out of work for months and months and months, can never return back to work. And she comes in and says, Brooke, I want to sue, ABC Restaurant for this. Can't do it. It's ordinary negligence, okay? Unless they were reckless or wanton conduct, you're not suing, you can't sue your employer. You give that right up in Connecticut because we have the workers' comp system. So some people say this makes no sense. Why? Well, let me tell you how valuable to you as injured workers the workers' comp system is. It guarantees you that your bills are going to be paid and that you are going to be paid for your rating. And if your employer doesn't have comp insurance, there's a fund called the Second Injury Fund that is set up to address these types of issues, okay? And they come in and they pay. So you get that comfort of knowing no matter what happens to you at work, even if it's your fault, if you trip over your own feet, you're covered, right? You're going to get your lost wages, get your medical bills paid, get you paid for your rating. It's fantastic. You give up the right to sue your employer on a third-party basis, unless they're reckless. I give my client this example. John Smith is on a roof. He's a roofer, right? Great. Very dangerous job. He's up on the roof. His employer knows it's icy up there and says, John, I need you to go up there. I need you to, grab a tool we left up there or something. John goes up there, slips on the ice, falls down and breaks his neck, right? He wants to sue his employer. It's never going to happen. The employer wasn't reckless. Now, the employer, you have to have intent for somebody to get hurt. The employer didn't want the guy to get hurt. He just wanted his tool, and he knew that it was wet and it was icy. Now, will some attorneys bring that case? Yes, you're going to lose. It's called Suarez. You're not going to lose 99% of the time. You're going to lose most of it. It's not worth it. An experienced attorney doesn't do it. There's a case called Suarez that prevents that from happening. However, John is back on the roof. Right? He's a roofer. His employer's like, look, John, I know it's icy up there. Go up and get the tool, and I'll go with you. Fine. They both go up there. And John says something to the boss about his mother, right? That's like a big thing. So he says something about his mother. And the boss gets mad and pushes him down off of the roof. He falls and breaks his neck. You're going to sue the employer for that. That's reckless, wanton conduct. But it's literally that level of recklessness, okay? Forget the mother comment. But the point is they have to have an intent that you get hurt, all right? That is the rule. So no, you cannot sue your employer for negligence due to a workers' comp injury. Any attorney that tells you otherwise, run. They don't know what they're doing. They're doing this as a hobby, and you do not want them anywhere near your comp case. Okay? Myth number four, you are not a citizen and have no case. That is wrong. If you are a citizen, bring in a workers' comp case. I get clients in here all the time. They're not citizens. And they're like, well, they report me to ICE. One has nothing to do with the other, okay? It's not like me, you having a comp case makes you any more apt to get reported to ICE, right? You could get reported to ICE just from living in Connecticut. It doesn't work that way. But if you are not a citizen, you still have a case. You still have the right to collect workers' comp benefits, okay? It's a little more work in figuring out what your wage rate is and what the benefits are that you're gonna be entitled to. But I represent people that aren't citizens all the time, and you have a comp case. So just because you know if you have a comp, whatever the case might be, okay? If you are not a citizen, you still have a comp case. So that myth is wrong too. Okay, the employer can fire you for bringing a comp claim. No, they can't, that's retaliation. You'd have a claim potentially under CHRO, and then you'd have another claim under for discriminatory discrimination for your disability or your injury. Can't do it. Now, can the employer down the road replace you if they show that they reasonably try to keep your position open and then had to fill it, like a small business? Mom and pop shop is two employees, you're one of them, you go down. Yeah, they might need to replace you, and they have to make reasonable efforts to make a job available for you under your restrictions when you're ready to come back. But that's never guaranteed, right, guys? It's not. But if you're injured and you choose to work when you shouldn't be out, when you shouldn't be working, you should be out, and then you really hurt yourself, the employer's going to deny it. They're going to say, look, it's his fault that he got hurt, or her fault. So follow the doctor's orders. They cannot fire you for bringing a comp claim. There's this big myth that everybody comes in, can my employer fire me if I do this? Absolutely not. And if they do, Lord help them the day they have to sit across the table from me, because we will do a discrimination case. We'll bring it under workers' comp, wrongful termination. We'll bring a CHRO claim. Trust me, it gets very bad for them very fast. They want nothing to do with it. Most insurance companies know this rule won't happen. I don't care what your employer says. The insurance company is not going to let them do it. And the insurance company calls the shots. Trust me. All right, myth number, I think we're at six now. You have finished treatment and back to work, so your case is over. No. This happens all the time, okay? People are very honest, which is great people. They're injured at work, and they get the treatment. Workers' comp pays them for their treatment, pays them for being out, they're released back to work, and they think the case is over. It's not. They have to pay for your permanency, okay? If you have a permanent impairment rating, which most of the time people do when they're injured at work, they not go back to 100%, they have to pay for that permanency. Now, there's a calculation, use this book. This is the new workers' comp book. You can get this in workers' compensation, any of the offices. And you calculate it. I mean, again, if it's been so far from the date of injury, probably gonna need a lawyer. Why? Because they're gonna deny it and say, hey, look, you've gotten worse. This wasn't the condition you were left in, et cetera, et cetera. But no, your case is not over. You get a permanency rating, okay? And if you don't work for the employer anymore, maybe that case will resolve. All right, so we'll jump to the next one. Lawyers get part of your checks when you're out of work. So this one is kind of sensitive, so we're going to talk about that. If I'm going to tell you my policy. Firstly, workers' comp allows lawyers to take a percentage of contested benefits. What does that mean? Literally, if the employer says, I'm not going to pay you, John Smith, and changes his mind the next day, attorneys that earn us all a bad rep say, that's contested benefits. Now I get 20% of all his checks. Guys, I almost used a bad word on this, but guys, that is crap. Do not fall for that. Contested benefits are a formal hearing, okay? You pay your attorney at the end of the case, we get 20%. So if I had to go to a hearing or two to get you benefits, your attorney shouldn't take 20% of those. That's ridiculous. And honestly, it's an abuse of the process and it's robbery. You cannot do it, all right? You can, and you can get away with it, but it's crap. And honestly, for the 20% of your checks that you're already getting, what, 67% or 65% of what you normally get, your attorney doesn't need to be touching those. So literally, this is how it goes. The employer calls and says, hey, John Smith, I'm not gonna pay you. I contact the insurance adjuster and says, we're not gonna pay you. We file Form 43, the insurance company. I go to one hearing, they say, okay, we're gonna pay them. And they think that gives them like the liberties to take a percentage of your checks. Crap, no. Honestly, I believe it's unethical. My office does not do that. I only do it only do it if I have to go to formal hearings, which is like a trial, okay? Then that's a real contested benefit. If they have, like, if they think you're lying or whatever and we have to go through this whole big rigmarole, sure. But you're not going to be getting checks weekly because they're going to be denying it. You're probably going to get a lump sum and it's probably going to end up being entangled with settlement anyways. Do not let your attorney take 20% of contested benefits, I don't care what the statute says, without a proper explanation and documentation. I deal with attorneys on this all the time. Attorneys use it as like an avenue to abuse the process and take money from you guys. It's crap. My office doesn't do it. And let me tell you, by not doing it, I probably lose $200,000 to $300,000 a year. And I don't do it because it's not the right ethical thing to do. And when you go to law school, you take an oath that you are going to represent clients diligently and ethically. And that is not ethical. And I'm waiting for it to catch up to all these attorneys that are doing it because the clients have no idea. They just think this is the way it is till they get into an office like mine. And I said, no, this isn't right. This isn't okay. So my office doesn't do it. Trust me, I'm happy to look at your case. My office doesn't do it. I don't care. If I have to go to a hearing or two to fight benefits, fine. Okay, doesn't mean I'm gonna take some of your checks. I get paid at the end of your case, I get 20%. Quite honestly, my fee more than pays for itself because by the time I get paid a year, year and a half down the line, I've attended multiple hearings. Literally each comp case we have has 50 to 100 notes in it. 50 to 100 different tasks that are performed on the file. Why? Because we have a full comp practice within my practice and this is what they do. This is all the paralegal, the attorneys do, and the comp practice is workers' comp. So we know what we're doing and we're good at it, and I don't need your 20% of your $400 check to keep my lights on. So it's crap, it's wrong, it's not okay, it's terrible, it's unethical, and I don't care which attorney sees this, like, it's mad at me for saying it. Somebody needs to put a stop to it because it's not okay. We get 20% at the end. That's what you sign up for when you take comp, be done with it. And it just makes me so angry because I get these cases sometimes. These attorneys literally had, the clients are, unfortunately in some firms, they make the clients do everything anyways, right? And so they keep on going, right? Fine, everything's good. And then guess what happens? Well, what happens next is that they file a Form 43, which is just procedural, by the way. Every case almost has one, and then attorney's like, yep, here we go, hook, line, and sinker. Now I get to take a fee. Wrong, don't let it happen. And I could talk about it for an hour, but I won't. I'm against it. I speak up about it all the time. I talk to my clients about it. I talk to other attorneys. I call other attorneys out on the floor all the time, and I'm saying, you should not be touching your client's benefits. This is wrong, and it's not okay. So that's my passion point there. Last myth, the employer must settle at the end of the case for the commission, or the commission can force them to settle. Wrong. The Workers' Comp Commission can't force anybody to settle anything. You don't get a trial. If there's no issue, right? If there are no issues that are being contested, then you don't get a trial, guys. Like, you, it's about finding a number that works for you and working for the employer, and then you settle the case. You can't settle when you still work there, okay? So you might not get a settlement. You might have to wait until you retire. But let me tell you something. The employer does not have to settle the case, which is why it's important that you have an attorney that does workers' comp and knows how much your case is worth and knows how to negotiate. And two, the commissioner can't force them to settle. I can't say, commissioner, force them to pay money. They can't do that. So literally, your case can stay open for life and forever. Okay, so this is why it's important that if you have a comp case, you have legal counsel. Because I can guarantee you, out of these 8 myths, none of you knew probably the answer to 6, or you would have had it wrong. And that right there shows that you need adequate legal representation, all right? My office, I have offices, we serve the whole state. We service Hartford, we have an office in Shelton, which is right next to Bridgeport. We have an office in Stamford, we have a remote office in Danbury. I meet clients in Norwich. Literally, at any given week, we're probably in all the jurisdictions. And I do comp because I love it. This is not, I mean, attorneys don't make tons of money on comp, right? I do very well on comp actually because we know how to work up these cases and we know what these cases are valued at. And I don't do this for a hobby, okay? I do this because I love to do it and not enough good attorneys do it. Let me give you the difference between myself and somebody else. Most comp attorneys don't do trial work, right? Because they like workers' comp and it's relaxed. Comp is not a trial. Okay, I try cases. I go to Superior Court and I try car accidents. I try slip and falls. I try dog bites, all right? I try child and sex abuse cases. I go to court and I try. I pick a jury. I present my case to a jury. Real deal, okay? Rules of evidence. Most of these comp attorneys have never tried a case. I go into a formal hearing. I have my exhibit list. I have my, literally, you would think I'm walking into court. And since workers' comp is so much more laid back, the attorneys don't know what to do with me. They're like, how does this woman know this and I don't know this? Well, I know the rules of evidence because it's applied in Superior Court. It's not applied in workers' comp. So, you know, you have to, yeah, if you want, I don't know why people, and I'm not just saying I'm the only one, please Google, but I don't know why people hire firms that don't have a big presence or don't have a big docket. Or, you know, you don't want to be the best case in the law firm, guys. All right, you don't want to be the biggest best case. Trust me. Because then that means they're learning from your case. You don't want that. You want to deal with a firm that's dealt with big cases. You want to deal with a firm that has a docket of 300 plus, that knows the commissioners that are in there all the time. You don't want to deal with, I mean, if an attorney has a PO box for an office, that's scary. If an attorney uses their home address for an office, that's scarier, okay? You want an operation where they can put money behind your case, they can put experience behind your case and power behind your case to scare the crap out of the insurance companies to pay you. That's what you want, and that's what we offer. Modern day personal injury law firm, what does it mean, right? People see the billboards, what does it mean? It means we do things like this. Utilize technology to educate people. Let them make their decision. People say, oh, your videos, you're teaching everybody stuff, they're not gonna need lawyers. No. My videos are showing people how they need lawyers, because my videos show people what the answers to questions they didn't know. And the fact that they didn't know it should show them that they need a lawyer. And there are going to be those people that carry themselves on, right? And are like, hey, you know what? I got this. I can do this. And that's fine. 90% now call me anyways. Here's the deal with comp, guys, all right? You're not saving yourself much money not getting a lawyer, because my fees are relevant at the end, because you're going to end up getting much more than you'd ever get on your own anyway. What we run into with these cases is that people do all the work, and the hard work is done in the first year. They do all the work, and then guess what? They figure, oh crap, I should have gotten a lawyer. Then you hire me, I get 20% at the end, but you've done all the heavy lifting, but you can't resolve it on your own. So now I'm coming in to save the day. Don't do that. Get a lawyer from the get-go. You're hurt at work, your first call should be to a lawyer. First call should be to me, but who am I to say? You can reach me at 203-399-0000. You can reach me by text at 203-399-0000. You can reach me by email at Brooke, B-R-O-O-K-E, at gofflawgroup.net. You can walk into one of my offices, 190 Trouble Street, floor 4 in Hartford, 100 Beersaw Mill Road, floor 2 in Shelton, Stanford on East Main Street. I'm happy to post that address for you too. That's by appointment. But walk in. I mean, I'll give you a cup of coffee. Just talk to, you know, I'm here for your information. There's no pressure. I can tell you there's not one client that can comment in this forum that has met with me that will ever say that they felt pressured to hire me. They honestly, to be honest, most of the people are saying, where are the papers? Please don't, I don't want to leave without signing. Oh, you can take the papers home with you. It's fine. I want to sign now because I know you know your stuff. I know you're good at what you do, and I know your firm is going to handle my case. And that's what you should strive for and want. You got to understand your lawyer's the person that's representing you. And a workers' comp case can change your entire life, as most of you know, all right? Or if you don't know, your friends know. Why would they not have the best representation? I don't know. I don't care about the past, how these things used to work. Oh, put people up on billboards. I have billboards, but I think they're pretty catchy. But put people up on billboards that never try cases. Put people on commercials during Sunday morning. How dare you interrupt my Sunday morning news? My wife hears all about it. Talk about how, oh, don't settle this, that, and the other thing. These firms that do this are the firms that settle. If you have to defend yourself on television, you're the problem. And I can tell you, I encourage you. So you guys think you're hiring these firms, right? These particular individuals, in fact, that are on the commercials that make you the promises individually around the billboards. Google them. Go on the judicial website, JUD.CT.gov, okay? And you can search attorney case lists. See the last time they tried a case. Bet you won't find it. Why? It's probably more than 10 years ago. Most of these people are marketing experts. They're not lawyers. I'm not gonna hold myself out as a marketing expert, but I'm damn good at marketing. I do self-marketing for the firm. I negotiate my own contracts. And guess what? I do it from my lunch break when I'm in court trying your case, because that's what a good lawyer does. This is not a business for me. This is my livelihood. And this is, honestly, this is the next big movement. And I've been able to utilize technology to make your lives easier and to make the lives of my clients easier. And by doing that, we've had such success. And people say, how did I not find you 10 years ago? That's what I usually get from clients. So again, I hope these myths have been put to rest, right? I'm not going to do anything dramatic and rip them up, but I hope they've been put to rest. And I hope you've learned something from this. And if you have questions, I want you to reach out to me, okay? I want you to text me. I want you to call me. Again, 203-399-0000. If you have a new case, potential new case you want to talk to me about, 203-399-0000, option 1, All right. You'll get my case intake team. They'll ask you a couple questions. Get me the message. I get back to you really, really fast. And again, there's no case too small, no case too big. You just need to know, you need to be educated. And at the end of the day, if you meet with me and you're like, wow, I learned a lot from her. I'm going to try it myself. Good for you. Great for you. But at least you got educated, you know, right? From somebody that's actually in the trenches on a daily basis. Guys, I appreciate you watching this. Follow us on social media, Goff Law Group. A lot of this is probably popping up on your news feeds randomly, and you're watching it. You're like, wow, this applies to me. Follow us because we post these all the time, okay? Like us on Facebook. We do a lot of contests. And honestly, you won't find a more passionate group of individuals that practice law in the state. I can guarantee you that. Again, call us, email us. Appreciate your time. And I hope you guys have taken something from this. Any questions, give me a shout. Thanks, have a great day, guys.